Okay, welcome to the second session. I'm very glad to introduce the next invited speaker. His name is Jan-Fred Fontaine, and he's a senior scientist at the Johannes Gutenberg University in Mainz, in Germany, where he works in the fields of biology and data science. He's the organizer of the Challenge in Computer Biology, which is a series of international workshops, and he's the editor-in-chief of Genomics and Computational Biology Journal. And his research interests focus basically on the applications of machine learning in molecular biology and on scientific literature mining. So the talk is about the importance of field-specific knowledge in machine learning with applications in biology. Thank you very much. Let's thank the speaker. And we start the talk now.
Thank you for this kind introduction. Yes, I will talk about biological data processing and analysis, what is known as bioinformatics. And so bioinformatics or computational biology is basically the application of computer science to biology. This could be in different subfields of biology, such as molecular biology, medical or clinical applications, or even structural biology, the objective being the data analysis and also the data processing, as eventually this big data field or the storage of this biological data. And so this is a very interdisciplinary field. Just to illustrate, this is my lab in Mainz, and I have just labeled the academic training of the members of the group. So you see it can span from computer science to biology to statistics, physics, chemistry. So it's very likely if someone like you wants to contribute to the field, there will be something to do. And so I was mentioning machine learning in the title because it's basically what I use in my research. I'm looking to apply this algorithm to analyze this biological data. But there are many more, and I will show you some examples of my work, but there are many more applications in biology. And this could be to define the subcellular localization of some proteins, to predict the interaction between different proteins, or if a protein is modified, like with a phosphorylation, the level of transcriptions, and many more. Also, personalized medicine could be part of it, or if you eventually you search the best way to make a diagnostic from the data. But today, I will focus on gene regulation and protein modification. And I want to go back to this simplified model of gene regulation. So I'm pretty close to the to the border. Yeah, so this would be the DNA, this long sequence. And some protein DNA interaction can occur. This would be a protein, this blue oval. And this will enable this gene to be transcribed in an RNA that will be later translated in a protein. If you remember the genetic code, we should have seen that at high school somewhere. So each set of three nucleotides can be translated in one amino acid. And then this will make a new molecule composed of amino acid. When it will be released, it will fold on itself in a complex structure. And the last part is optional. The protein can stay in this state. But it can happen that this is modified by an enzyme that's coming here and adding this phosphate group to this protein. So the last part is really, let's say, optional. And I guess we should all be familiar with this picture. And today I will talk about three of these steps. the protein-gene interaction, the gene transcription, and the phosphorylation of the proteins. Yeah, so I'm starting with the gene transcription, especially the amount of RNA molecules, and I will take this specific example on the thyroid cancer. So when I started to study this data, I wanted to classify the thyroid tumor thanks to the data. On the other hand, there are pathologists in the hospital that are classifying these cases based on images, and this would be just a different way to classify an automatic. And the problem, if you ask several pathologists to classify these images, they will not agree all the time on which exact disease you have. And it can be, if you ask to three different pathologists, they may agree, all of them, for one case, only in 10 or 20% of the cases. So it's very difficult to do. But this has an impact because the different types of tumor you have can be very different in terms of survival or aggressiveness. And so this is why if there is a way to improve this classification, we can use it. Then, as I said, I used the gene transcription level, so the amount of molecule that is produced thanks to a gene. And because if I can do that, I will have maybe a tool to do this automatic diagnosis or prognosis. And at this time, this was very interesting because arise these high throughput biotechnologies that are microarrays and later RNA sequencing that enabled to get the data for all the genes at once. And before, you would be able to analyze the few genes. And now, thanks to this technology, you have a picture of all the genes of one tumor. And then you can do for one patient, another patient, the control, etc. So this is what I'm showing here. This is a representation of this data. So this is a big matrix, if you want, and there are 8,000 rows, and each one is for one gene. And there are 160 columns, and each one is for one patient or one tumor or one control. And the color just shows the level of transcription, the amount of molecule for this gene in this sample. And so it's a lot of data to process. You cannot go like manually and do it comprehensively. And simply by running hierarchical clustering on the rows, you will find like clusters of genes, basically. And this means that these genes across the different samples, across the patient, across the tumor, as a set of genes, they are coordinated. The amount of molecule is correlating. And this points to this gene regulation I was mentioning, that some proteins can enable the activation of some gene in some conditions. I did not say that because, yeah, the gene may be present, may produce these molecules in some patients, but not others, in some disease, but not, or in muscle cells and not in heart. So this is very condition specific. And here I just wanted to show you an example of what we do with ontologies in the biomedical field. So this is gene ontology. It's a set of terms that defines the gene function. And they are used mostly as keywords to annotate the genes. And now as you have a list of maybe 100 genes here, you don't know why they are all together, but mining the annotation thanks to this ontology, you compute this overrepresentation of terms, and you may see that most of these genes are involved in this immune response or apoptosis, etc. So this is an example of domain-specific ontology, how we can use it. So then it's interesting to analyze the data in this direction, the genes. But if you organize the colons automatically with this algorithm, it's more difficult because if I represent these samples, so the patients, and each point is a patient, basically, and this type of disease is here, except this is the control wild type. So normally, we like to show such a plot because the data often just cluster very nicely the groups, and it's showing that the data is already very good, but this is not easy. And by running some basic classification algorithm, we see that for each class, we get some results, but for other ones, it's very bad. So you cannot classify so the sensitivity and precision, these two bars. And yeah, then, so the maybe you wonder why I was not using other algorithm. So it was a long time ago, maybe I was not aware of everything. But then also we tried several ones. This one actually worked pretty well. And yeah, do you really want to get better results? Is the question. And because what happened is that mining this data, analyzing it, we realized that not all these classes made sense, basically. And one, this class exactly, is called atypical follicular thyroid adenomas. Thanks to additional biological evidence, like mutation, we were able to qualify them as papillary cancer. So this class was actually not a real one, let's say. It was just a class, some samples in an early stage of a known established class. So, this was to show you what we can, an example of what we can do with machine learning in mining these gene transcription levels. I would like to explain the task that is to predict phosphorylated proteins, especially their site. So, as I said, this protein phosphorylation can happen or not, but this is a very common process. It can, maybe a third of the human proteins can be phosphorylated temporarily. And to be phosphorylated, this is an enzyme called protein kinase that is doing that to another protein, and there are maybe more than 500 of them. This is a very essential process in the cell. It's involved in many cellular function and pathway, especially because when a protein is modified, what could happen is that its structure can change and its function. So it can eventually relocate in the cell in another place or be activated or eventually interact with new partners, other molecules. And of course, if this is not well regulated, this can lead to cancer or other disease. And there are many tools actually already and methods to automatically try to predict where a protein can be phosphorylated, so the phosphorylation sites. And they are very useful, especially because to do that with a molecular experiment is, it's a significant cost and time to involve. But I would like to explain a bit more in detail. So in a protein, that is, we can imagine it as a sequence of amino acids, only three of them can be basically phosphorylated: threonine, serine, threonine, and tyrosine. And if I want to, if I check the literature about these methods to try to predict these sites, they fall in two categories. Those were kinase-specific or general-specific. So kinase-specific is that, as I said, to be phosphorylated, a protein needs a kinase. And a kinase may recognize just a set of proteins and not all of them. And this is an example of what is depicted here. It's actually, you would align all the sequences around a phosphorylated serine, S, all what is known, basically maybe your training set, the positive cases, and you can compute the frequency of each amino acid around this one that is phosphorylated. You take it, you take a small window around the sequence, and you check the frequency of these neighboring amino acids. And so you see what you can expect. So there is sometimes some signal that there, after the P or the T, you expect a P. This can happen. But you see, it's not a super strong motif or consensus you can build. And but this is something you can do. You may say, I focus only on this one kinase, and I try to predict everything for this one. And on the other hand, what I'm doing is to predict for any kinase. So basically, I just want what is phosphorylated if it is a serine, whatever the kinase, because it's not known all the time which kinase is doing that. And yeah, so this can be used as a feature for training in your machine learning or other things like surface accessibility. So let's say this is a sequence of your protein. It's just a computer representation. In real life, this may look a bit more like that, where it's folding on itself. And one of this ball will be phosphorylated, but it's more likely it can be phosphorylated if it is here at the surface, or if better than if it would be at the very core, very inside the protein. So there are different solutions, as I said. It's a field that, if you do the literature, maybe you will find more than 40 or 50 different software to do that. And I was also here focusing on three of them because they are consistently reported to be high-performing. So this would be this first table for different tools to predict the serine and their performance, the threonine and the tyrosine. And you see this MuSight, PhosphoSVM, RFPhos, here and here, they are very often the best ones. And just by checking the features they use for training, they are listed here. This could be, as I presented on the previous slide, but also, interestingly, the KNN, actually. And he also, but overall, as a summary, if you take them, these types of features are reported to be the most important in the prediction. But I was interested in tyrosine phosphorylation, this Y, the letter Y, and I can see that the performance is lower than the other cases. So why? I'm not sure. Maybe the sequence around this tyrosine is less conserved across the different sites. Maybe the data is smaller. But actually, it is known that, contrary to the phosphorylation of serine and threonine that occur in all life forms, basically, the phosphorylation of this tyrosine is happening just on some species and not the other one. So there was these are species, and there is a point in evolution where this system of tyrosine phosphorylation appeared, and not here. So we translated it like that. So this is basically our input data for training. One new human sequence on the very top focused on a single amino acid and a window around it. And you can get in other species the same protein that may be slightly different because it was mutated by evolution. And you align them, all of them. So on the top, it would fit to this first group of species, in the bottom to the second group. And this would be the perfect case where we see our amino acid that is very conserved in this first set and not much in the second one. And we would say this is a good candidate because here it's conserved in the species that have this system to phosphorylate it. So maybe it's important. And here, these species that do not have the system, it's not conserved, so it's like irrelevant for them. So it's exactly what I was looking for. So then we've made an implementation. So it was done by a student in the group using several features, including the one I was talking about, this evolution, let's say, features. But I have to say this is really preliminary. And what is actually not implemented, this is two most important features that I was talking about. So, yeah. And whatever. So if I implement something with that, some features with our ID, and yeah, we miss these two good ones. I would expect if I run my algorithm, I will not get better results, especially on the serine and threonine. But I'm curious to see what would be the results on the prediction of the tyrosine, where I especially added this feature. This is just a look at the database we are using to give you an idea about how many sites we have to train and to test. So the answer is exactly as expected. So here we would have the precision recall curve and the ROC curve for the serine, and the same for the threonine. So it's very small, I'm sorry, but so the violet line is our method. In this ROC curve, we are especially better than this existing solution that are basically state of the art, just because we added this new feature, and even if we miss the two important ones, so you guess the outlook is we will very soon implement these features we are missing and expect to be even better. And the last point I wanted to discuss is about protein-DNA interaction, because it's especially involving DNA sequencing. So again, this protein may bind to the DNA that will enable all this process to happen. I have to say that this is very simplified. So there may be more than one protein, and these could be other types of proteins, not always the same protein in multiple copies. So how does it relate to DNA sequencing? I can explain the very basic idea about the DNA sequencing technology. Let's take this one. Let's imagine you have a biological sample with DNA that is represented by this very long, this line. But in reality, it's a very, very long molecule. And the technology is not able to process it, to sequence it as it is. The technology is able to process, to sequence maybe 100 letters at a time for one molecule. But if you take all the chromosome, maybe you have to process at the end 3 billion letters. And so the biotechnologies are smart, and they find a way to fragment this very large molecule in small pieces. Because I did not mention, but this DNA technology can run in parallel. So it can process many molecules in parallel, but for few letters, basically. And this is what is done here. You fragment this very large molecule in small ones, and you provide that to the sequencer. And the sequencer will return you these short sequences here. So now it's inside your computer here. And you have millions of short sequences of 100 letters. And if you're really interested to rebuild the genome, because maybe this one, it was in your pipette, but you have no idea about the letters, then your task is to align this short sequence, find overlap, and build the longest long sequence you can to reproduce the genome. But I am interested in protein-DNA interactions. So this is an adaptation of this protocol for this case. And the adaptation is that, here we have many fragments of this very large molecule. Some of them, they have interaction with proteins, because they were close to the genes we have seen earlier, and maybe in some of them, a protein is bound. And there is a way to filter only these ones from those that have no proteins, or to filter the only ones with the protein you like, of interest, because of a specific antibody. And so you will basically cut this part in two, fragments that you are not interested in, and fragments with your protein. And then only this fragment, you sequence them to get the short sequence from the machine, the reader, the sequencer. And now the task is a bit different because you are not really interested to rebuild the full genome, but you're interested to, you already know the human genome. It was sequenced some time ago. So you take the database here, it's what is known as a human genome, and you try to find the right location of each of these small sequences. And when you see an accumulation of this fragment at some specific location, and especially if you compare to a control experiment, then you may say, yes, this is here where my protein was. And this is how, and this is done for the whole genome. And at once, you get the data for one protein, maybe thousands of places where it was on the DNA. Yeah, so this was the technology. So you say time is now a bit limited, but you have a choice then, because you're this guy with a computer, what data you use. Either you use basically what will be each sequence, but you may use what I said, this only this peak, this place, binding site, and this is represented just by a list of coordinates, chromosome 7, start nucleotide, stop nucleotide, so this boundary here and here, and there could be other colons for quality. Or you may just work with the genes, because yeah, this is happening close to one known gene. Yeah, I just keep the name of the gene. And by the way, you see how the biologists are able to compress from 5 gigabytes to very few kilobytes the data. Without, and still being relevant. So what is also interesting is the available experiments. During the last years, there were many different consortium in biology that collected experimental data from many. And this is very nice now. If you start in the field, you don't have to wait some data to be produced. You can directly go there and download every data you can. Maybe in this specific case of protein-DNA interaction, I can't find 9,000 experiments. But the observation is that maybe still if you take this is a specific cell, this is a specific protein, and this is a number of experiments for each one. So this may be okay with 5 replicates, but sometimes it's a single one, and very often it's just 0. There are too many possibilities, basically. And this is exactly what we are doing, is trying to predict what could be this experiment that was never done. And this was already addressed by a few methods, with machine learning, and they simply use the information from the all other experiments related to the same cell type and all other experiments related to the same protein. And this is where we wanted to try to improve. So this would be 2 examples of these methods. They may use the data, as I said, as these short sequences and try to predict this profile across the DNA. Or they may find try to use exactly the sequences to predict other binding sites. So I'm out of time, so I will quickly go to the end. And our contribution was actually to work on the gene level. As I said, it's very small data with a specific algorithm where we try to still be more accurate. And the final results are here. So we can be more accurate if we include in our training algorithm a bit more knowledge on the biology, especially that what you can find as signal in this experiment related to the cell is not the same, is not as strong as the one related to the proteins. And in summary, I wanted to show you a few examples, and imagine you can already think about things to do with that. I wanted to say that the machine learning field is very important for biology, so it can produce diagnostic tools, state-of-the-art methods, obviously, and it allows us to predict new experiments, and this is great. And just also, if you work in this field, there is still always this biology that it's complex and always something from biology you can add to be even better. So I very welcome you to be interested in this field, and I would like just to thank my lab in Mainz, especially Stefan Elbridge, who was working on the protein-DNA interaction, Zoe Brunet on the protein phosphorylation, and thank you very much.
Okay, so we have some minutes for questions.
Basically, thank you, first of all, for your presentation. I have 2 questions, please. First of all, for slide 10, I think that not all the mRNA can produce protein. So relying on mRNA sometimes can give us not the right answer. I'm not sure this is what I know from before. Please correct this for me. The second thing about, I would like to ask you about how many physicochemical properties you measured and which tool you are used. You use PROM, is it? Or which tool you are using for measuring physicochemical properties?
The physicochemical properties?
Yes.
It's just some annotation of each amino acid. Mm-hmm. The charge or the hydrophobicity, these type of things. And for the mRNAs, yeah, it's a simplified model only. Yeah, there are genes that can be used to create proteins. There are protein-coding genes, and there are also many genes that do not create proteins.
Yes, I
understand. And I do not, I was not processing them.
Okay, that's it. So the number of physicochemical properties that you are measured? That's my question.
I think 8.
So which tool you are using for this? PROM or which one?
For the, or no, you it's an annotation in the database for
okay.
it.
Okay, yeah. That's fine. Okay, thank you.
It's me here.
A small question. If I understood your data set, it is limited, of course, of human data sets and illness data sets. If you could merge your data set with other labs that works with your field, biotechnology, DNA, protein, what do you think? How can improve this merge to new results?
I'm not sure about if I used several data sets because they were generated by different labs.
Okay.
And if I train with that, this is what we do.
Okay.
So we do that. We take all the data sets, they are produced by different labs, especially because we go for these public databases. And it's not easy because the same data set, the same. Okay, if it's produced by different labs, it will not be perfectly the same. If I say the genes I can find in one, and in another one, maybe there is 70% of overlap. This can happen. Sometimes it's more, sometimes it's less. What we have seen for some, the more replicates you compare, the more labs you ask to do the same experiment. Mm-hmm. In some case, you actually more and more go for a unified set where everything overlaps, at least in two labs. So this is possible, but this is very rare. Maybe we had to go for six of these such data sets to find most of the information at least one time reproduced. So this is the complexity of the biology. And it's true, if we do a prediction, it's very difficult to compare to what do we want to compare. If we have only two existing data like that, the idea is we put them apart, we take them out of the data, we try to predict and we compare. But if there is only two, as I said, maybe we are not having the full picture, and it's very difficult to find a way to compare exactly.
Okay, it's understood this field. Many illness now, it is very, very ethnic problems, biotechnology. Race, ethnic populations, it's something difficult, something special. And in our globalization of our world, population, it's changed since living places, okay? And maybe merge not only merge data sets, data not only between labs of Germany, for example, French and Europa, maybe labs in the Asia, China, and other countries will be help to diagnose and to learn a data set and to implement it in the Europa, for example, in this mixed population.
Yeah, obviously. So maybe one can think we have really a lot of data, but it's few because of what you say. That, for example, we use the human genome, but there is no single human genome. But in most of the studies, we have this reference genome, and we work with that. But in reality, we all have differences, and especially some you can find with geographical locations, they may differ. This is true, and this is data, we don't have it, basically. There are some databases of full genomes for different individuals over, across the planet, but they are still limited to a few hundreds or a few thousand of people. But I would say the main application now, and then we work with a standard reference genome for what we do, because it's possible. And the main application of what you say is more on personalized medicine, where it's very used, and you may ask your own genome to be sequenced, and then thanks to some analysis and existing mutation and comparison to these ethnic groups and response to drugs, you may have a different treatment. So this belongs more to this personalized medicine field nowadays. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. I think we have, in terms of time, we have to move to the next speaker. Thank you very much. If there are extra questions, we probably can take them offline. We'll be available during the day, okay? So thank you very much again.
Thank you.